back at you, those things!
We saw this recent footage that we're going to show right now, and we would love to critique it.
Oh my gosh, are we putting that up?
But the problem is...
Oh jeez.
That is going to piss off everybody. Okay. Here it is, guys. We're just going to have it
run. What
is that? It's the Morihei Ueshiba.
Oh.
Okay.
Now we've made a million enemies.
A million enemies.
Hi.
Hi, enemies.
Hi, haters.
Hi. Everyone who thought they were on our side now doesn't like us. We understand that.
There are some bad things about that video.
Yeah. Now, here's the thing. Here's the thing. It would be easy to say that this God. Ability is far beyond our own.
There's so much history in this.
It's easy to say that this ability is far beyond our own, and because of that, it's real, and we just don't know how it's real. So let's just say that, and we could leave it at that.
But you know it's not going to be left at that.
Because it's not that, is it?
No. They're going to want us to pick it to pieces. And the truth of the matter is...
We could easily pick that to pieces.
Yeah, I mean... Because, oh, God, we're going to make so many enemies from this.
Because, one, cognitive locking, cognitive pressure, cognitive rotation... It's old hat. It's something that we've been doing. I've been in martial arts for 30 years now, boys. And the two
and girls.
the two girls that watch the show.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, we've been here. And there's a way to do it, and there's a way to get it done. If there's another way to get it done that I'm not aware of, and that's like the mystic power of non-touch,
mm-hmm.
That's awesome. Here's the thing. You can train and entrain your students. So I punch Bri. I uppercut him, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So he comes in and throw the punch. I come in and I uppercut him. Boom! If I keep doing that,
mm-hmm.
It's not going to take too many uppercuts before his body goes back before I touch him.
Right.
So the punch comes in. I come in. And that's going to happen because right. He knows I'm coming because I hit him and he knows that hit's coming.
Right.
So now...
Conditioning.
Right. So now I can lock him with intention. Is it really locking him with intention?
It's conditioning. Come on, let's look at that.
You know?
it happens automatically because it's been done 5 or 6 times in a row.
Because every time this thing comes in...
I lock myself up out of fear.
Out of reaction.
Out of reaction.
Out of fear. Out of reaction. Out of conditioning.
Out of holy shit, it's coming.
Right. So, is it possible to then, without the punch, right?
Right.
Me to come here?
Of course.
Yeah. It is. So I'll give you that.
Oh, so many haters are going to happen, man.
I'll give you that, okay? But here's the other issue.
Mm. You have to be pre-programmed to do
right.
that. Right. You can't do that with somebody off the street.
That's the issue.
Yeah.
The issue is, if that guy's in the dojo training all the time, then yeah, maybe. Here's the second issue that I have with it. I don't want to train my students to flinch.
Oh, jeez. You opened up a can of worms
there.
You
do that because,
right?
Because
now you know he's conditioned to react to that. Oh, yeah, I'm going to be doing that a whole lot.
Yeah.
Right.
And then when the guy from the street comes in, he's boom, boom.
Yeah. Here, you're just...
He doesn't
like,
even have to do it.
Yeah.
He can just fake it.
Yeah.
I can fake it. Not good.
The
not
conditioning good. Is not good at all.
Not good. Now, there's a way to condition that's positive. I mean, it's an yin and a yang.
Mm-hmm.
It's the yin and yang.
Talk about psychology, man.
There's a positive form of conditioning, and obviously, there's a negative form of conditioning. Now... Those of you that are saying that this is not conditioning, this is some mystical power that this man possessed, wow, really? Don't drink the Kool-Aid. mean, I'm sorry. Listen, I love Morihei Ueshiba. Don't get me wrong.
Oh, he's awesome.
The guy was phenomenal. Okay, he learned from Sokaku Takeda. Enough said. Don't drink the Kool-Aid. There's real technique and there's false technique. And what we're witnessing time and time again as we run this video on a loop. Here. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's probably right here.
No, we're running the video.
Oh, running the video. Oh, sorry.
We're running the video.
Running the video here.
Right. While we're running this thing, come on.
You got to know his conditioning, folks.
Come on,
it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out this man has flinched at almost 1,000 of his uppercuts and just knows what to do when it's coming.
Right, and now Ueshiba Sensei does not need to touch him. Now, the idea that this man has mystical powers, I've never seen that before.
I can see it getting to that level where you just do this and they'll go,
and we've seen that. I mean, we have seen that. I've seen many students do that. Now, here's the thing. I've demonstrated with students where I lock them up so many different ways, and because I lock them up in a particular way, I feel their body start to like contour to mine. And that's not me getting better. That's them getting used to being locked in a certain way. Mm. I make it a point to never lock them that way again. Mm. To trick their body, to send it somewhere else. It's because you don't want to create patterns like that.
And God bless you for that, because you're saving us from being conditioned.
You do not want to create patterns like that.
And shame on the sensei that you manipulate that.
I understand why they do it. I mean, it must make you look great.
It makes you look mystical.
And fake in my eyes.
Well, and people who understand what's going on.
Yeah.
Some people don't understand what's going on.
We've been locked so many times, and now the guy's doing this to lock you.
Yeah.
It's not real, guys. No. I'm sorry, it's just not real.
It's conditioning.
It's just not real.
You cannot do that to somebody that walks in from off the street.
No.
And there's video of that.
Yes.
There was a
time and time again.
Yeah, you'll see.
Key masters, masters,
yes,
all this
and
stuff.
They got tested,
and they get tossed and locked up and beat up. And,
yeah,
and
the no touch system.
It's just not real. Now you have to understand. You have to understand a little bit about Japanese society too. In that there's this social desire,
mm-hmm.
especially at that given moment in time, that there was a social desire to want to believe in that.
Mm. Which is a mental state right away.
Right. They want to see the old man go like this.
The framework is there.
And the guy over there go, you know, it's in their cartoons, and it's just a part of their societal norm. So I get it. We need that. Mm. But here's the thing. Don't glorify Ueshiba Sensei, O Sensei, for something he wasn't doing. Glorify him for all the things that he did do. He was an amazing martial arts practitioner, and this is a black smudge on that.
This is the science of psychology.
Right, but real quick, that is a black smudge. Like, that video should be destroyed. It should never be looked at again, because you want to preserve the beauty of the practitioner, and that's not beautiful.
Yeah, it's true. They should not be sharing that.
No, never share that. Yeah. That's gross.
Yeah. Well, it reminds me of everyday life.
Hmm.
When you're driving, or even if you're not driving,
hmm.
and you see police lights from 10 miles away, and they got nothing to do with you, but what do? Well, everybody tenses up.
I don't, because I'm white.
And you know what's messed up?
He's right. It's horrible.
Yeah.
You know, we should do an episode. We should do an episode on police brutality.
But it's the conditioning.
My friends are putting it all over Facebook with like just police going nuts.
You know what? It's only in certain
places.
I have family that are police officers. I understand the struggle that they're going through. I understand how they're being portrayed. There are good cops and there are bad cops. It just so happens that the bad cops,
no doubt,
are being displayed, man.
And I've heard this many, many times where it's don't honor the man, honor the position. Or don't, what is it? Don't respect, you don't need to respect the man, but you need to respect the badge.
Mm.
That's difficult, because if someone's trying to arrest me and I don't, you know, on nothing, I don't know.
How do you fight that? You've been conditioned to not.
Sure, well,
right.
It's just difficult.
Black folk get shot. Y'all mugs just.
They shoot us too. I'm sure.
No. Don't make me post a video. Where there's a black guy and a white guy, and the white guy does the same exact thing that the black guy does. Black guy gets shot. White guy gets talked to. It happens.
You know what it is? Black people are very intimidating.
And why is that? When we were...
I'm just joking. I'm not going to defend that position.
No,
I'm joking.
Why is it that...
I'm joking.
But no, that does exist.
I don't know.
That is... Oh my God, it's a black guy. And it's... Oh, there's a white guy. We'll just talk to him. Just... You okay, buddy?
I think that that's it.
Oh my God, there's tons of videos, man.
Really?
I don't know why, but that's what we've been conditioned to believe.
That's lousy.
It sucks. It's conditioning. Again, the lights are off in the distance. Right? It doesn't matter what color you are. It doesn't matter what creed. If you've been in trouble, I'm sure there's like ex-convicts.
Late at night, though, it would give me like a...
Come on! It happens. When you see those lights, even if it's an ambulance. Right? It's in the rearview mirror.
Yeah. Oh, I gotta get off
those
to the
lights
side.
Have been conditioned us. That they've conditioned us to react to those lights.
And the boop!
Oh, God.
That boop really doesn't... That's boop. Very uncomfortable.
Yeah, boop! Yeah, you feel it go through the car. It's like, whoa! Oh, my God! Oh, and then the lights is like confirmation. It's like, boom! Your spine locks.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. They've been conditioning us. The same thing with the Weishibots. It's conditioning.
Yeah. I watched them do that. I watched them do that to my son and my daughter in elementary school. They were doing this thing where it was like they want all the kids to be quiet. So they do this, it goes like this, it goes, and the kids need to stop whatever they're doing,
and they go,
oh
yeah, they did that to us in school too.
Oh, hell no.
Yeah.
I told them that they are not to do that, that when they hear that, they are to purposely not listen to that.
Oh, wow.
And I told them that if the teachers have any problem with it, tell them that I said it's against their religion. You know? Our God says that you don't listen to that.
Yeah, that's really...
Because that's like mind conditioning nonsense.
That's the beginning of it.
Hey, you're not doing that to my kids.
That's the beginning of it.
Now what we're going to do is just drill this little thing in here.
Oh,
it's
going to
implant something. It's going to be fine. I just don't want that. I don't want any part of that nonsense.
Homeschool.
Yeah. You know, that conditioning, it's true. You're right. We're all on this path of conditioning, aren't we?
Homeschool. It really, the whole thing is conditioning from start to finish. Homeschool. I'm telling you, because the whole thing is a plan. I don't want to get too deep.
Yeah, no, but, it's true. I've read about it. Where
the history books are wrong. You know all the stuff that we learned?
Oh, my God.
Christopher Columbus?
Oh, man.
Come on, man.
Oh, man. Thomas Jefferson, man.
Come on, man.
Thomas Jefferson, you know that he paid more? It was like, who did the scalping, huh? Did the Native Americans do scalping? No.
Oh, God.
Thomas Jefferson paid more for scalps than anyone else.
Are we going down this road? You know, the 40 acres and a mule never happened.
Yeah.
Because if we had any kind of substantial financial stability, they would not be able to milk us in the judicial system in order to get us back in chains.
Right.
See, if we have money, we can buy a lawyer.
Right.
But if we don't have money, we go right back into chains.
Right.
It's just, you know, 40 acres and a mule was the pipe dream.
You know what?
We're a commodity.
All the time.
Yeah.
Now, you know, yeah.
It's awful.
None of us live free, truly.
No. No. None of us. It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Are we going down this road?
No.
Okay. But in any case, conditioning.
We're talking about conditioning.
Conditioning. It's all conditioning.
And
welcome to America.
You know, cognitive locking exists. Yeah. Going back to the way Shiba thing, cognitive locking exists. We kind of went off path there, but there's Aiki in the movement. Aiki requires touch or requires the reaction
from a condition.
From a conditioned response. Mm. Now, if there is... Now, here's where there's some gray area. The belief that it's real. I can lock a man. I can do this. It doesn't always work. Usually I have to hit the guy. I can lock a man with a surprise attack where he sees it coming and he ducks away. Once again, that is conditioning. Very rarely Is it a natural reaction? The natural reaction is often no reaction. If a person's not trained, they usually just get hit. I'm sorry, but I've been on the mat way too long to say anything different. It is almost never happens. If the person has no training, they get punched. That's what happens. If they have some training, yes, you can work off of their trained reactions. Like if they're a boxer, you can work off that. So when you throw the punch, they're going to do that, and that's what gets them locked, and you can double weight them on their spine, and you can toss them, lock them, toss them, do all kinds of things. Yes. Once again, what's Weishiba doing? Come on, guys, open your eyes.
You know what that started with me in middle school was this one. Remember that?
Yeah.
When people pump you?
Yeah.
You know, oh, yeah, that was conditioning too.
Yeah.
A lot of us been through that too.
Yeah. And we also, I don't know if you got this, but in our high school, it was two for flinching.
Oh, no. No, we didn't get that.
No?
Y'all had two for flinching?
Yeah, because
that's
bad. That's
brutal.
Because you know what's worse? Now you have no reaction. Somebody goes like, this deal, and you just like,
oh, and you just take it.
Because you're not going to flinch. You're not flinching.
Take my flexibility out completely. Yeah.
It sucks.
Damn.
Not smart.
Worse conditioning
stupid
than we had. Yeah.
Stupid kids.
Oh, my God.
If my son tries to play that game, I had to train that out of myself.
Wow.
Because it's just a silly childhood game. I'm not going to flinch.
What? You better.
Stupid childhood games. And did you ever do this one?
Oh, yeah, with the whole, you know, you get punched. Yeah, yeah, I remember that one. Everybody went, I didn't look.
Yeah,
yeah.
Now,
and then you can reverse it and be pulled.
Sexual connotations to that game.
Really? Like, why are you doing that?
I'm going to put it down without looking. Okay, so for those of you that are functional and didn't know that game, this was the game.
Lucky you.
Kids play this on the play yard.
Conditioning at its best.
Conditioning at its best. You make a circle, and if you...
And I'm doing it now. Like, I don't want to look.
Don't look.
If you make a
put it down low, usually, like, down low.
Yeah.
And so then you can see the...
Like this.
Like this.
Like.
Hey, Dave.
And you make a circle, and if he looks, I can punch him.
Right, but if I just stick my finger
then he can punch me.
Then I can punch him.
Yeah.
Silly, stupid boy games.
Oh, my God.
And, creates really horrible habits.
I wonder if they had that going on in Canada.
I wonder.
Probably not.
Some back conditioning there.
Yeah, conditioning. That is some crazy stuff, man.
You know what's funny is when we first got in touch with the Canadians, and then shout out to the Canadians, we love you guys.
Heck yeah.
Well, we got made fun of because they would always make jokes like, oh, we don't have TV where we are. What's that? You know, they're making jokes like we think ourselves so much more advanced.
Really?
That was the joke for a long time. But you know what's really funny about that? As I got to know them, I'm like, oh, yeah, of course. I know they have radio. I know they have GPS. I know they have the same technologies.
Yeah.
And then you go up there to visit them.
Right.
And
they kind of don't. they want it, but they ain't got it.
just come on. And you know what?
That is interesting.
You go to Japan, you go to Tokyo, and it's like, holy crap, man, this is the future.
Yeah, they got technology at the
wazoo. Because they do.
Yeah.
They have some stuff, they're like, oh, well, you don't know what this is? And I'm looking at it like, no, what's that?
Yeah, the Canadians were so about...
So we're a little backwards, too.
What were they talking about there? That the ingredients in that coffee, right? They're saying that they were putting... Somebody was putting cocaine in their coffee because everybody was addicted.
Tim Hortons? Yeah, and they do. Because who the heck has a shop? This Tim Hortons shop, and they're everywhere.
Yeah.
They have, like, lines around the block. And they go, oh, well, you can't go to work without some Tim Hortons.
Yeah. What's the thing about Tim Hortons? Right? Well, they used to put cocaine in, and we're just all hoping it's going to be in there.
I don't know if they ever did, but that was the joke.
That was the joke, yeah. Somebody put drugs in the
coffee. And like, we have the best. And I'm like, what do you mean?
Talk about conditioning.
And the joke was Dunkin' Donuts was better than theirs. Not that it is. Who cares, right?
Nothing's better than Tim Hortons.
Nothing's better. Yeah. It's like national pride. So we brought them to Dunkin' Donuts, and they're like, well, this is pretty good. That's nothing. You gotta go to Starbucks.
Oh my god. You want some quality dirty water? You go to Starbucks. Come on,
that's
now.
It's all crap to me, but whatever.
Wow. Conditioning.
Whatever you're into.
Conditioning. And we've all been conditioned.
Yeah.
Walmart conditioned the shit out of all of us.
Yeah.
Crap out of us. Excuse my language.
Yes. Yeah, crap's a lot better.
You gotta have a beep button on the iMovie. It's gotta have a beep button. It's gotta
That would take forever.
Well, do I curse that much?
I curse occasionally, and I feel bad about it.
Okay. Like, maybe we should have a segment of Bri's curses. Huh? T would like that. Like just a whole beeping session.
No, thanks. That's a lot of editing. The poor editing crew will be up very late.
We'll edit this shit.
That really takes away our legitimacy, saying bad words.
All right, so you can edit that down.
Right.
Did that for Tia. That was for Tia.
Yeah.
In any case, conditioning, folks. Be careful of what you're being conditioned to.
Please don't think we don't love Aikido. Aikido's great. We love all martial arts.
You really
want to
go down that road? You really want to go down the Aikido
road? All martial arts is great.
Run at me.
Don't be mean.
I can't do anything unless you run
at me. It's a training drill. It's a training drill. Don't be mean.
I'll never forget that.
Well,
I'll never forget that.
I experienced that too.
And he's like, wait, you have to run at me.
It's a beginning.
I do?
It's a beginning.
What if I don't? Well, I can't do anything if you don't run at me. Oh, well, I think I'll just stay here then.
There are levels to Aikido, you know. Yeah, no, I know. You know what I thought?
I love Aikido.
You know what I thought was whacked about Aikido? Not that we're getting down on Aikido. This is what I thought was whacked.
Aikido is awesome.
This is what I thought. When I was in Aikido as a young man,
mm-hmm.
I was like, well, show me your strikes. Because I didn't understand. They were doing these like shomenuchis and these yokenuchis. And I was like, which is, to those that don't do it, shomenuchi is like this and yokenuchi is like this. And I said, well, show me your strikes because, you know, I want to understand. And they go, we don't actually do strikes. And I'm like, well, how do you train strikes? Well, we don't train strikes. I was like, don't you hit rocks? I mean, well, maybe you hit sand. Do you hit sand? No, we don't hit sand. Okay, well, do you hit heavy bags? Like, do you hit anything? No, we don't do that. I go, okay, well, just follow me here. Okay, if your students are not proficient at attacking, how are you going to become proficient at defending? And they go, oh, well, we have students that come from different martial arts and stuff. Okay, so you're relying on the skills that they're learning somewhere else to defend against those skills. I hope you're recruiting a lot of boxers and street fighters then. Because, right?
Yeah.
It was just wacky to me. It was just weird to me. Like, I want my students to become awesome at striking, so that they can break anything they hit, and then I want them to hit this. Then I want them to try to hit this. Because that makes me better. I want to hit things and break them, and then I want to try to hit my students. So that gives you the edge, man. That gives you the edge. And it's just wacky, and maybe not all Aikido is like this, but what I've experienced. And you know what? I'm certain that not all Aikido is like this.
It can't be, right?
That's like saying all white people are like this, you know? You can't say that. So I'm sure that there are some really great Aikido schools that are dealing with some awesome multiple attacks where the guy's doing leg and hand combinations, elbow striking, gripping and smashing them with their heads. I'm sure that they're doing a lot of combination striking.
Not just retreating.
Not just, yes, Tenkan all day. There's nothing wrong with that.
Backpedaling all day.
You do whatever you want to do with your life.
Did I show you that YouTube, the twins that do that? You do whatever you do. Fuck you!
At the end of the day, you don't have to follow advice. You can do whatever the fuck you want to do.
Okay.
Yeah, it's good.
But, absolutely. Aikido has its place.
Yes.
So does karate. So does kung fu, actually.
No, it doesn't. No, it doesn't.
Okay. All right.
No, it does.
All right. You know, there's levels to this.
Right? Absolutely. There's levels to everything.
There's levels.
And you know what? You know, you need to get into the jacuzzi slow, some of you. I like jumping in sometimes. Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. You gotta get in slow, acclimate yourself. Nothing wrong with that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Enjoy the bubbles and then put the rest in, little by little.
You know.
Technique of the week.
You're doing kind of the other one, yes? Strong straight. Yeah, he's just strong straight down. Remember the triangulation point? That when you draw him there, he falls right to it? So he steps here to this triangulation point, and then as you spin, you draw him right into the triangulation point. And you just have the knife there that you rubs on. Here. You're pulling them and drawing them in. You're just drawing them down to the triangulation.
Here.
Down. You're going backwards.
Here.
You need to be here. Look at this is where you're going. You're here. You're going here, which is great. And then you're drawing them here, which is a lock. I'm drawing here. Fold and a projection.
Oh,
no, you're doing I get out of the way, right? And then I spin and put that there.
So you're not pulling him out of the
I'm mostly projecting his arm to that triangulation point, and then as soon as that becomes uncomfortable, I project his elbow there and then his shoulder there.
Nice and tight.
That projection. It's about this. This is essential because you need to be able to do things without walking. So like this is just a perfect technique. It's absolutely perfect. But what happens if he's not locked? What happens if he has those Missy arms? Remember Missy Duet or
Dalbert.
What was it?
Dalbert.
She had these crazy arms that just kept spinning. So what if you can't lock it? If you can't lock it, we can still get that triangulation point. Here, this is not locked at all, right? He bends this way. He can still, even though he bends this way, he'll still fall toward the knife.
Right, Sensei.
So, especially, you know, walking it off. Especially if, as we're spinning,
right, Sensei.
Body goes up. And then, there's no block.
Really touch my shoulder.
Okay, so we're at a wedding in Canada, and it was Gib Sensei's wedding, and most of the guys from LaRue are there, and I run over. It was at the reception, and I overhear a bunch of Canadians talking with some people from England. They were family members that were visiting. They're talking about the Americans and how they're on the dance floor dancing and how we're crazy. And that's just American lifestyle. They're all crazy. Because these people were pretty conservative, you know, bourgeoisie, possibly upper class. And they're talking about how they eventually get on this topic where all Americans are gun-toting crazies. So I let them go for a little bit, and I'm over listening, you know, I'm overhearing them. And I'm drinking a beer, and I said, excuse me, but that's just inaccurate. It's just inaccurate. We're not all gun-toting crazy people. Now, I have this all set up from the start. John, my student John, is getting hot, and he's taking off his suit, and I know about the t-shirt underneath. So, I mean, I set up this joke, but honestly, God was on my side that day because it was just awesome. So I said, I beg to differ. And they go, what's that? And I go, well, Americans aren't like that. We don't all have guns. We're not gun-toting crazy people. I said, well, I am. You know, I have a
HKG3, and I have 9mm Beretta, and I have snub nose 38, and I have, and I start rattling off all these guns that I have, and I'm looking at them, and I go, but I'm the exception to the rule. I go, Faust, since they come here, I go, Jacob, tell them about how we're not all gun-toting crazy people. He goes, wait, what? And I go, well,
I can just see the look on his face, yeah. Like,
what are you talking about, Sensei? And I go, well, just tell them about how many guns you have, you know, because you don't have any guns. He goes, well, you know, I have the 30-06, and I have the over-under, and I have the, and he starts naming all these guns that he has. And I knew, obviously, I'm going to call on all the students that have guns. So I call on another student who has guns, and another student has guns, and then I call on John, and it's just hot enough, and he's sweating, because he's dancing and stuff, he's sweating, and he takes off his suit, and he's got his t-shirt underneath, and we were changing, you know, before in the hotel, and I knew what he was wearing, and I just thought it was absolutely perfect timing and everything. He's got a t-shirt with Charlton Heston on the t-shirt, holding two shotguns, and it says, "From my gold dead hands." It's awesome. It was awesome. So I said, John.
It's like you're not proving your point very well.
Oh, it was the best. It was the best. I said, John, get over here. John. He goes, yes, Sensei. I was like, tell him about how we have no interest in guns and how you don't have any guns. He goes, what? I said, well, just list the guns that you have. And he goes, well, you know, I got the Mac 11. I got the F-16.
The 30-30s.
And he just starts going off. I got the, what was it? He has ridiculous amount of guns. It was awesome. It was awesome.
Oh, they're God. Probably just looking at you like,
it was awesome.
We're not proving your point.
You know what was the best about it? Is that I kept a straight face the entire time. I had just enough beer that I could be, like, stoic about it. I was like, this is obviously, you know, inappropriate that you're saying this about our country, you know. And they're all in absolute shock. Like, they could not believe what was going on. And I finished that story with, you know, it doesn't really matter, because once we run out of our natural resources, all of this is going to be part of the U.S. anyway. It was awesome.
How did you not get in a fight?
It was just awesome. And then they're like, what? You know, we're a sovereign nation. And I go,
it's like something that I'm like,
and what are you going to defend it against? Like, what are you going to defend it with? You know,
it's like something you would see in a sitcom.
Oh, man, it was awesome. It was something you'd see in a sitcom. It was like, because it was reality, it was awesome. In a sitcom, probably people would just think, oh, that's poorly written. No, it was amazing. That was amazing. That he wore a t-shirt with Charlton Heston from my cold dead hands.
That is not a coincidence.
I'll tell you what. No, that was the first thing that I thought. I entered that conversation knowing how I wanted it to end. And I was just kind of like, you know, you're hoping for the flush.
Yeah.
And it totally happened. I was like, oh my gosh, it came through. It was so perfect. Like, it couldn't have been planned that well. Because I'm going, John, come over here. And he's going, oh, it's freaking hot. And he's taking the, that was perfect. It was absolutely perfect. And the whole time, they're listening to the list of guns. And I had to call one other student in, because I was like, oh, he's not going to take his shirt off yet. I'm like waiting for his shirt to come off. And the one student I did call over, I wasn't even certain he had guns, but luckily he had like 7. Which was awesome. But moral to that story is, Canadians are right about us.
Yeah. Oh, man. Oh, my God.
Thank you.